has been with us from morning up to this time. As we are starting our program, I am going to, I didn't welcome those of us who've joined online. I welcome you also in a special way. At this point in time, I'm going to request Elder Kalusa to pray for us, to open for us in prayer.
Shall we pray? Our God and our Father in heaven, we come before the throne of grace this evening. Lord, we want to thank you for the many blessings that you've continued to shower upon us and for the privilege of prayer this evening. As we are about to listen to your manservant speak to us, ways that you've prepared him to speak to us today, we ask Jehovah that may you please help us to hearken unto your word. We want to pray that you may also stand with him so that whoever is following may not be derailed, but understand that which you want to say to each one of us. This Sabbath evening, we want to commit our brothers and sisters who are watching and following online, that Lord, may you also be with them, that together we shall be able to worship you and glorify your name. This we pray and ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen and amen. At this point in time, I'm going to invite Sister Naomi to give us a special song.
You feel more broken than whole.
What do we say? Thank you, Sister Naomi, for that special piece of music. Without further ado, I would like to invite the preacher that we're having this evening, who is Elder Kakoma, Pastor Kakoma, is the one who's going to take us this evening. Pastor.
Happy Sabbath, Church. Amen. I'd like to apologize to for starting a bit late. We were supposed to start at 18, but this is 18:17, and we hope that we'll be able to share the word and not within a short space of time that we have. Today, our theme is sacrificial love. It's derived from our theme for the week, going also into the Sabbath. Tomorrow we are having a Holy Communion where those who have accepted Jesus Christ to be their personal Savior will have or participate in this service. And so I encourage all of us to participate because it's a very necessary and important process in one's Christian journey. And I just have a few thoughts coming from the book of John chapter 12, reading verse 12 and 13. The Bible, come with me to John chapter 12, verse 12 and 13. The Bible says, "The next day a great multitude that had come to the feast, when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him and cried out, 'Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel.'" Shall we pray? Father, we pray that may your spirit be with us. In Jesus' name, amen. A little bit of background to John 12. When you go to John chapter 11, you have the story of Lazarus being resurrected from the dead. When Lazarus was resurrected, the next thing that happens is that the Jews begin to plot to kill Jesus because by now his fame had gone overboard. All those naysayers that doubted the genuinity of Jesus' ministry and capability to perform miracles were ashamed because evidence had been provided that Jesus has got power even over death. And so John chapter 12 begins with a feast at the house of Simon. This was a feast that they threw after Lazarus was resurrected. A few things you will notice is that it was at this same feast that Mary anointed Jesus for his death, where she went with the expensive oil. And by the time that we get to verse 12, the Bible says when he moves from Bethany into Jerusalem, the Bible says the next day a great multitude came to the feast when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. And as they were coming, a lot of people came with the idea and the backdrop of what Jesus had done. He had healed the sick, he had raised the dead, he had fed the 5,000, he had done so many miracles. And so people were excited about meeting this Jesus. You'll notice that in verse 13, the Bible says these people took palm branches, like a religious sect that does, that carries palm branches. I remember in the year 2000, when they were talking about the coming of Christ, they carried a lot of these palms around them and shouting, "Hosanna." And they said, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel. Now, it might interest you to note that the word Hosanna actually means someone who is saving. And so as they were carrying and as they were shouting Hosanna, they were basically saying, the Savior has come in our midst. And as they were doing this, I could imagine, and later on as you read along, you can imagine they were thinking that the Savior had come to save them from the political reproach that they had suffered under the Romans. But you later on find out that the ministry of Christ was not like in the way that they thought his ministry would be, because his was to come and sacrifice himself for the sake of humanity's sins. And quickly, when you go to John 3, verse 16, the Bible tells us that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. He sacrificed himself for the sake of our sins and my sins. When you go to Romans 5, verse 8, the Bible tells us that, but God demonstrates his love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Even when we were not worthy to receive Christ, he died on our behalf. A few things you notice about this audience is that they are not looking for Christ to save them from their sins. They are looking for Christ to save them from their poverty. They are looking for Christ to save them from the hand of the Romans. When Christ looks at them, and when he looks at these people that were singing and shouting Hosanna, he knew that just 4 days in between, this was on a Monday, 4 days in between, by Friday, around almost the same time, there'll be the same people shouting, crucify him. And so Christ, even when they were saying Hosanna, blessed is the King, even when they were shouting all along, Jesus knew their hearts. And so he is not like most of us, or he's not like me. If I knew that today you are singing Hosanna, and by Friday you say crucify him, I would definitely tell you to say, look, you need to stop pretending. But Jesus knows what they are going to do on Friday, and he allows the situation and allows the procession to go. Now, I don't know how many of you would be comfortable with such a procession where you know that the people that are singing praises to you and telling you that, no, you are the best, just a few days later will be saying something otherwise. Now, this actually shows us how God operates and how God loves us. Most of us, as human beings, our love is mostly very conditioned. We respond to love based on how people treat us. If people don't smile on us, even if the church is very beautiful, we may as well stop worshiping in that church. If people don't show us affection or accept us in a certain particular church, we'd often leave that environment. So most of our love is based on how people treat us. But we find that God's love is not based on how we treat him. It is based on the fact that his love for us is very much different and so dynamic from the love that we find in the world. As we go through this period, and as we are going to prepare ourselves for Holy Communion, I know many of us have stepped in many places, and I know many of us may not feel worthy to walk before Christ, but I want to remind you that what you have done in the past may be huge and big, but God still shows his love towards you irrespective of where you have been. And you do not need to wait until you become better, because Jesus did not die for perfect people. He died for sinners like you and I. And so as we prepare for this Holy Communion, embrace and accept the love that God shows towards sinners like you and I. It doesn't matter what you have done. It doesn't matter where you have been. Christ knows you fully. You see, they say that if people fully knew who preachers are, most of us would not sit down and listen to the preacher's sermons. But you see, God's love is in such a way that he fully knows us. He fully knows where we have been. He fully knows, even when we confess that, look, tomorrow you're going back to the same thing. He fully knows us, but he still fully accepts us the way we are. And he accepts us so that he can transform us. It is my prayer that you may accept the love of Christ in your life, that he will transform you as we meditate upon Holy Communion. May God bless you as you meditate upon his word. Amen. Shall we pray? Father, we thank you for the love that you show towards us. We acknowledge that the world is rough and hard because sometimes we are judged based on our characters, our past mistakes, and the things that we have done. But we thank you because your love towards us is not based on what we have done, but it is based on the fact that you love us and you created us. It is for this reason that we pray and ask that may you help us as we go through this process and as we go through this memorial, that may you deepen our love and our relationship for you. We want to pray, Father in heaven, knowing that we have many of our friends and colleagues here at church who are not well. Our prayer is that may your hand touch them and heal them from their healthy challenges. Some of us, O Lord, are spiritually sick. It is our prayer that may you revive us. As we go back home, may your angels that excel in strength and in glory attend to us. We ask all this through the mighty and victorious name of Jesus Christ. Amen.